Morning. Welcome to First Presbyterian Church. We're glad you're here today. Philip Brown, longest commute to church this morning. Well done. Baltimore to Newcastle. Proud of you. Love your dedication. On behalf of everyone here, thank you. Oh, and happy birthday, too. Just had to call you out a little, Philip. No problem. Couple announcements for me this morning to get us started today. There's a fellowship luncheon being held after worship. Following lunch, the Krissicks and the Hodges are going to talk about their recent trips to Russia. There'll be a free will offering accepted to defray the cost of lunch. Please stay. Sloppy Joe's are on the menu, so walk on down the fellowship hall after church for lunch. Next, the Handbell Choir is coming back, and they'll be rehearsing this Thursday at 6 o'clock. Anyone who's interested in playing is welcome. Teens, youth group, you're especially encouraged to join us. If you have not played before, we will teach you. So if you have any questions, please see Don Rogers for more information. The annual Excellent Easter Extravaganza is being held on Saturday, April 8th at 9 o'clock. Our traditional pancake breakfast will be followed by Easter activities for the kids, including the annual Easter egg hunt. If you're bringing your child, please bring a dozen plastic eggs filled with candy. Everybody else, we need more eggs filled with candy. So if you could do that, fill them, bring them here to the church. We would really, really appreciate it. Invite your friends and families to come out. If you would like to help that day, please let us know. We could use all the volunteers we could get. So, Excellent Easter Extravaganza, April 8th, 9 o'clock, here at the church. The order forms for our Easter flowers are in your bulletin this morning. Flowers are $10 each and can be purchased in memory or honor of someone or in celebration of a special event. The deadline to order is April 7th. There's a soup and scripture community Lenten lunch this Wednesday at 12:15 at Shenango Presbyterian Church. This week, Pastor Chris Weichman will be the speaker. To help plan food accurately, please call our church office tomorrow morning with a reservation. This could be one of your last times to hear Reverend Weichman. He'll be leaving in May. He's going, moving to Erie, Pennsylvania. So you can go there this Wednesday and hear Chris speak. Lastly, if you'd like to pray with someone this morning, meet today's prayer partner, Dave Purdy, down in front of the sanctuary following worship. That's all for me. Let's worship God.
Please stand if you are able and join with me the call to worship. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
O God of all times and places, we praise you for your mighty acts of yesteryear. Stab us awake to your present day miracles among us.
Stab us awake to receive your remaining love, our privilege to speak to you in prayer, our capacity to be filled with the Holy Spirit, and to celebrate by telling your story.
That every person may come to know the glories of your redemption, we come to worship you, O Lord, as we gather beneath the cross of Jesus. In his name, amen. The proof of God's amazing love is this. While we were sinners, Christ died for us. Because we have faith in him, we dare to approach God with confidence. In faith and repentance, let us confess our sins before God and one another using the unison prayer of confession. Let us pray. O God, you are eternal parent, and we confess as your wayward children that we keep running away from you. We even forget sometimes to do the obvious and end up doing the very thing we wanted to avoid. We know come a Sunday morning, we're in trouble. Please, O God, give us another chance. Help us to give ourselves to you so that a wonderful, adventurous life will be ours. All in the name of Jesus the Christ, in whose name we lift up all our personal sin, seeking forgiveness. Hear the good news of Jesus Christ. This saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, that we might be dead to sin and alive to all that is good. Let us remember that in the name of Jesus Christ we are forgiven. And all the people of God say, Amen. As God has forgiven us, let us show one another forgiveness by offering the peace of Christ.
Maybe all the kids come on up front here like we've done before. Yeah. Yeah. Have a seat. Today we're, as you know, we're working our way through Holy Week, the last week that Jesus was alive before he was crucified. And we're talking about those things that happened during that Holy Week. We call Holy Week the last week. And the symbols on our Lenten banner help us remember some of the things that happened during that week. And we've been talking about the symbols. Today, we're going to talk about this symbol right here. What are those things? What do we call those?
Dice.
That's right. Those are dice. And here's some actual... This is actually what dice... This is the right size. These are real dice here. This is what... And I'll put them right here. And I brought some fuzzy dice. These are my favorite fuzzy dice. But why do we... What are dice for? What do we use dice for? Yeah, we use them in games, don't we? So that some games have, we have to roll the dice, right? And you roll the dice, and what's the number I got there? 10. Five on one and five on the other. That means I get 10. So that means that in the game I'm playing, I either get to move 10 spaces or 10 places or I get 10 chances. Whatever the game means, that's the number I get. Let me roll it again. What am I going to get this time? What's that? Four. That's four. Yes, four. That's four. Now, the reason we're talking about dice this morning, and we know what dice are for, the Roman centurions, the guards who crucified Jesus, who put him up on the cross, they rolled dice that day. Jesus was put up on the cross, and when he was put up on the cross, he was stripped of all of his clothing, and there is all of his clothing then became the property of the guards, the centurions, the Romans who put him up on the cross. So they got to keep his clothes. But there was one piece of clothing. Everybody, all the guards got one piece of clothing, his shoes and hat and everything, except there was a tunic, a robe that he wore that his mother gave him supposedly, and it was a really nice, pretty robe. It was his most nicest robe he had. And they didn't want to tear it up because there were four guards and they all got something, but then they had the robe left over. Who's going to get it? Well, what the guards is it? Well, let's roll the dice for it. And that's what they did. And they rolled the dice. And the centurion, who got the highest number, got to keep the robe. And so, do anybody know what happened to the robe? Anybody have any idea? We don't know what happened to the robe, but there's a story about it. And if you read about what happened to that Roman centurion who got the robe. But the thing was, there are the guards rolling the dice for Jesus' robe, and they miss what's going on up on the cross. They didn't realize who Jesus was. They're more concerned about winning the robe. And that's sometimes what happens to us. When we play a game, we want to win. We roll the dice and we want to win. And then we get mad or sad if we lose. But Jesus says, it's not whether you win or whether you lose. It's how you play the game. How you play the game is more important, always, than whether you win the game or lose the game. And that's what it's like in life. It doesn't make any difference whether we win or we lose in life. It's how we play the game, how we live our life. That's what Jesus is trying to tell us in Scripture. That's why we come to Sunday school and church, to learn how to live, how to play the game of life. So remember, the next time you want to win, it's just a game. It's not how you win, not how you lose. It's how you actually play the game. That's much more important than whether you win. But the Roman centurions didn't even know that. But we do know who Jesus is. And that's so, so important. So the next time you roll dice, remember, Jesus wants you to play the game. Don't worry about winning or losing. Let's pray. Dear God, thanks for letting us play games. We thank you for the game of life that we're involved in. Help us to play it well. Help us to play it so you're pleased on how we play our game. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Your sermon worksheets are ready for you for the sermon, so we'll see you later.
Pray with me. God, source of all light, by your word you give light to the soul. Pour upon us the spirit of wisdom and understanding, that being taught by you in Holy Scripture, our hearts and minds may be open to know the things that pertain to life and holiness through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's listen to the Word of God and read responsively from Psalm 22, verses 12 to 21, which can be found on page 581 of the Pew Bibles, as well as projected on the wall. Many bulls encompass me, strong bulls of Bashan surround me. Open their wide mouths at me like a raving and roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax, it is melted within my breast. My strength is dried up like a poster, and my tongue sticks to my jaw. You lay me in the dust of death. For dogs encompass me, a company of evildoers encircle me. They have pierced my hand and feet. I tell of others, they stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. But you, O Lord, do not be far off. O you, my help, come quickly to my aid. Deliver my soul from the sword, my precious life from the power of the dogs. Save me from the mouth of the lion. You have rescued me from the horns of the wild oxen. This is the word of the Lord.
Our New Testament lesson is from John chapter 19, and we're reading verses 23 to 24 and 38 to 42. In this section of John, no picture so shows the indifference of the world to Christ. There on the cross, Jesus was dying in agony, and there at the foot of the cross, the soldiers threw their dice as if it did not matter. We also note that in this incident, John finds a fulfillment of Old Testament prophecy, as we just read. They divide my garments among them and cast lots for my clothing, from Psalm 22. And the two significant garments of Jesus were the robe and the shroud. So let's listen for the word of God. First of all, verses 23 to 24, which talks about the robe. When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his garments and divided them into four parts, one part for each soldier, also his tunic. But the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it shall be." This was to fulfill the scripture, which says, "They divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." So the soldiers did these things. Then we skip to verses 38 to 42, which talks about the shroud. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus. And Pilate gave him permission. So he came and took away his body. Nicodemus also, who earlier had come to Jesus by night, came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds in weight. So they took the body of Jesus and bound it in linen clothes and with the spices, as is the burial custom of the Jews. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb in which no one had yet been laid. So, because of the Jewish day of preparation, since the tomb was close at hand, they laid Jesus there. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Oh God, may you bless not only the readings from your word, but also the playing of your word and the singing of your word, and now the interpretation of your word, that it all might become your word to us on this Sunday in Lent. Amen. Sometimes you can't win for losing. A preacher went to a penitentiary to speak to the inmates. He started, "My fellow citizens," and then he remembered, no, when you go to prison, you lose your citizenship. So he started again, "My fellow convicts." No, that's not right. Finally he said, "Well, I'm just glad to see so many of you here." Sometimes you can't win for losing. It was like the two elderly gentlemen who had just retired to Florida, and both of them were very hard of hearing. And they got to talking to each other one day, sitting on a bench, and the one fellow said, "Neighbor, do you have salvation?" No, but I'm sometimes bothered by arthritis." You mean you're lost?" No, I'm not lost. I live right up the street." "Well, tell me, are you ready for Judgment Day? It's coming real soon, you know. It may be tomorrow or the next day." "No, I'm not, but for goodness sake, don't tell my wife about it or she'll want to go both days." Sometimes you can't win for losing. Our banner symbol today is the dice. As I was talking to the kids about the dice, there's a true story that sometime years ago in Las Vegas, Nevada, a man wearing Levi's and cowboy boots walked into a casino, calmly put down on one roll of the dice $777,000. And he won. And then just as calmly, he got up and he walked out with $1.5 million in cash. Now, what kind of man would gamble $777,000 on one roll of the dice? Amazing. The soldiers at the foot of the cross rolled the dice for high stakes, but they didn't know it at the time. They rolled the dice for the robe of Jesus. What kind of men rolled the dice for the robe of the King of Kings? I think we are a lot like those soldiers at the cross. We get so concerned about getting the robe that we miss the man. We end up rolling the dice for a ticket into heaven, and we end up losing our soul in the process. Now, how we've reacted historically to the only two articles of clothing that Jesus wore is very interesting: the robe and the shroud. The robe which he wore in life as he walked this earth, and the shroud which he wore in death. Do you know about the robe and the shroud? Well, what about the robe? The clothing, as I mentioned to the kids earlier, of executed criminals became the property of the soldiers who were detailed for crucifixion duty. A Jew's clothing in those days consisted of five articles of clothing. Very simple. There was some kind of headdress, an inner garment, which was the tunic or the robe, sandals, a girdle or belt of some kind, and then an outer garment, which would have been some kind of a cloak. Therefore, Scripture says there was something for each of the four guards, but in addition, there was the robe, the tunic, in this case, woven all of one piece, which was worn next to the body. This robe, the only thing of considerable value that Jesus had, was too good to be torn into pieces, it was better that one man should have it. So by the chance decision of the dice, one person would get it. It would not be torn. It would not be destroyed. So unconsciously, they were fulfilling the Old Testament prophecy from Psalm 22. They divide my garments among them and cast lots for my clothing. By the way, Egyptians introduced dice into history. So the soldiers cast lots by rolling the dice for the robe of Jesus. There's a legend that Mary, Jesus' mother, had woven this seamless tunic, this robe, and had given it as a gift to her son when he went out into the world. This was the robe that he made holy by wearing it. And from the hem of which healing power flowed at a touch. One might wonder what became of it. Some of you might remember and know that there was a book and a movie produced around the legend of the robe. The book entitled The Robe was written by Lloyd Douglas, came out in 1940. And then a movie by the same name based on the book starring Richard Burton and Gene Simmons came out in 1953. Still a great story, a great movie. And that particular story follows the life of the Roman soldier who won the robe and the influence it had on his life. The seamless robe had unique qualities if you read that story or see that movie. May I suggest, for your homework assignment this Lent, rent the movie, read the book. It's still good. The robe. William Barclay has pointed out that the description of the robe given in our text is the precise description of the lined tunic which the high priest wore. Now, you know, the function of the priest in those days and ours is to be a liaison between God and us. In fact, the Latin name for priest literally means bridge builder. Jesus was the perfect priest. The emphasis on the seamless aspect of the robe is simply a way of focusing on Jesus as the high priest, the ultimate bridge builder through which we come to know God and are redeemed. It seems that the seamless robe has been lost. The robe, symbolic of the man who wore it, without flaw, a perfect weave of character and love, a designer robe with the imprint of the weaver of life, has been lost. We gambled and we lost. And the robe, like the man, is still lost to many. What about the shroud? When Jesus was laid in the tomb, we read that he was wrapped in linen cloths. Actually, the process was to lay the body after preparation on a sheet, a linen sheet, 14 feet long, and 3 feet wide. And the body was laid on one end of that 14-foot sheet, and then it was brought up, the sheet was brought up over the head and down over the body. It was an envelope effect. And there's strong evidence to support the fact that the original shroud is still in existence. Now, many books and many articles and TV specials have been produced over the last few years on the shroud. Someone was in town not too long ago talking about it. Westminster College had an issue on it last year, and it comes about. You can read about it and see about it in many, many ways. Some of you have followed that scientific research on the shroud. For those of you that haven't had a chance to do that, to sum up very briefly, The shroud has been preserved after a checkered history of travel in a church in Turin, Italy. Back in 1920, the shroud was allowed to be photographed for the very first time. And that photograph, rather the negative, revealed that there was more to the shroud than met the eye. The negative plates, rather than the developed picture itself, revealed that the mysterious images on the shroud showed the life-size images of a corpse. And upon further examination, since that time, research by teams of scientists from all over the world have come to the conclusion that this shroud does bear the life-size images of a man who had been crucified. Now, the imprints reveal numerous details which correlate with the gospel accounts of the events preceding the crucifixion. Up here on the wall, that's just the headshot of the shroud, the negative of the shroud. That's not the whole body, and that would too much room there. But you get an idea what it looks like if you haven't seen it. And when you see the whole shroud imprint, there's imprints on the hands and feet, which correlate with deep puncture wounds caused by spikes, bruises around the face and the body caused by scourging, head wounds which only could have been made by a crown with sharp protrusions being pushed down over the head, an opening on the right side under the ribs caused by a spear. All those events happened. And the microscopic examinations of the shroud revealed the dates and location of origin, which point to the exact time and place of Jesus' existence on earth. All the evidence seems to prove that the images on the shroud would make this the shroud. The question is, how did the images get on the cloth? The research on the shroud by the scientists and the various experts, it was all done. It was allowed to be done to prove that the shroud was a hoax. But their conclusion, after all the years of study and all the research, and I quote, they say, if this shroud is a forgery, it would have been had to have been done most skillfully by someone who anticipated photography 100 years before it was invented. Someone who possessed knowledge of the crucifixion that only recently has been discovered by historians. Now, even with the debate over the accuracy of some carbon dating procedure, and they pretty much concluded that one, that it is accurate, they conclude, and they said, if this is a forgery, we still don't know how the images got on the cloth. If you want to know more about what they think and how it happened, you need to do research on the shroud. We're like the scientists. We analyze and pick apart the gospel and try to write off all the miracles and try to explain it all away. And in the process, we miss the risen Christ. The shroud might still be with us. It even bears the image of Jesus' likeness. But when we put it under the microscope, it defies explanation. So does the resurrection. It's simply God conquering death. It's as simple as that. It's as complicated as that. Like the shroud, we can't prove Christianity. It just exists. It won't go away. Just like we can't analyze love and laughter. It's something we do. Christianity is here. The shroud is here. Love and laughter, it's here. They're here. But we can't prove any of it. Science tells us that nothing in nature, not even the tiniest particle, can disappear without a trace. Nature does not really know complete extinction. All it knows is transformation. Everything science has taught us strengthens our belief in the continuity of our spiritual existence after death. Nothing disappears without a trace. Yes, we gamble for Jesus' robe in hopes to obtain perfection, but like the soldiers, we can gamble our life away. Oh, we might gain the whole world. And in the process, we might even win $1.5 million. But is it worth losing our soul? We analyze Jesus' shroud to get proof texts for the resurrection, and like the scientists, we come up where we started with a mystery, a miracle. We are so like the gambling soldiers and the searching scientists. The seamless robe can be a way to understand the Jesus of history. The mysterious shroud can be a way to understand the Christ of faith. The one really doesn't make any sense without the other. The Jesus of history and the Christ of faith go together. The robe and the shroud are really one and the same as we see them through eyes of faith. Both are ways of verifying the simple fact that God loves us. And he sent his only Son that whosoever believes will not perish, but will have everlasting life. Someday, after mastering the winds and the waves and the tides and the stars, we shall harness for God the energies of love. And then, for the second time in the history of the world, we will discover fire. But we'll never get it by rolling the dice. Gracious God, may the words on my lips and the meditations in our hearts always be acceptable to you. You are our rock and our redeemer, in whose name we pray. Amen. Let us stand to sing. Before our offering, let us pray. As Christ was offered in obedience to you, O God, so we offer ourselves and our gifts to be used in your service. As you took Christ's sacrifice and filled it with your life and power, so use our gifts and transform our lives, that we may be the living presence of your reign on earth, now and always. In the strong name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. Let us return to God the offerings of our life and the gifts of the earth. Let us do so now. As we come to our prayer time, please note the names on the back of your bulletin under the prayer chain. All those folks need our prayers. Is there anyone that isn't there, that's not mentioned, that we need to pray for this morning? Anybody that needs our prayers that we aren't aware of? Pray with me. O merciful Lord, who through your Son faced temptations in the wilderness, and who knows the temptations that beset us daily, grant us grace to stand firm in our faith, that we may bring to every temptation both courage of spirit and strength of will, never surrendering to those desires which violate your love for us. May the knowledge an example of Jesus, so fill us that we will set ourselves gladly to the tasks of prayer and meditation and self-discipline by which we are strengthened during these days of Lent. May the example of Jesus teach us the greatness of true humility and call us to watch with him in his passion. Prepare us by faith in him to meet the crises of our lives with steadfast endurance. even as he showed us. We confess that we are not always faithful under duress, that we sometimes blow hot and cold as seems expedient. Lord, forgive us when we cannot even watch 1 hour. May your forgiveness be our occasion for repentance and rededication. In this moment of prayer, we confess that no relationship with others is trivial or unimportant. We see those names listed in the bulletin, those that need your healing touch, who are sick or suffering, touch them. O Lord, bring your peace to countries and neighborhoods ravaged by violence or war. Bring your peace to those who are in peril. O Lord, we lift up to you those who are bereaved, who are sorrowful, who are lonely. Console them. Great God, have compassion on those who are suffering in mind or spirit. Heavenly Father, fill those with doubts, the assurance that only you can give. And let your tender mercy lighten any person whose names we lift up to you in the silence of our soul. We come now asking for your blessing, willing to receive the sacrifice of your Son, as we lift to you all of our joys and concerns and heartaches, and ask boldly to be blessed and healed and forgiven and comforted and loved, all in the name of the one who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us stand to sing.
Thank you.
look forward to seeing you all down the hall for lunch and for the program that follows. And let the benediction in this prayer be our prayer for the food, so when you go down there, you may partake as it is served. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the food that has been prepared. Bless it to our bodies. Bless us to your will. And we thank you for the program that follows that will share with all of us those marvelous adventures in this world of ours. We thank you for that. Our worship is over, but our service begins. So may the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May grace give you the power never to sell yourself short. Grace to risk something big for something good. And grace to remember that the world is now too dangerous for anything but truth and too small for anything but love. So God, take your minds and think through them. May God take your lips and speak through them. May God take your hearts and set them on fire. May God lift up his countenance upon you and give to you and those you love and those whom nobody loves his peace. Dismiss us from this place, but never from your presence. We pray in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Jesus.